Yeah, I don't know where the clicker went. Hold on, let me just go. I need to go.
Like very off-putting.
I don't know if you could.
Okay. Can you hear me through this microphone? Well enough? Yeah. Okay, great. Well, I do want to thank everyone here for coming. I said this is what we view as just an opening conversation, and we, as part of ASAP Bio, indeed would like to be involved in kind of a long-term conversations with scientific societies. So, you know, this is not a first and final event. This is really, I would say, the beginning of an engagement. And I want to thank everyone here for coming. Jessica will describe a little bit more about ASAP Bio, but you know, we're a group of practicing scientists who are, I think, concerned and taking an active interest in kind of the future of scholarly publication, how we share our results. And, you know, just by introduction, none of us are strangers to scientific societies. We've, you know, spent a lot of our time and blood, sweat, and tears working with scientific societies. So I'm Ron Vail. I'm from UCSF, also with Howard Hughes Medical Institute. And probably my biggest claim to fame was hiring Stefano at ASCB at the time. But I've been involved at ASCB for decades. I was also president of the ASCB, so you know, certainly familiar about scientific societies. And also for about probably 10 and a half months, there wasn't a executive director at ASCB, so I worked with Kevin and others kind of almost on a weekly role in kind of the operations of ASCB. So Cynthia Wahlberger will be talking next. She's from Johns Hopkins. She's a member of so many scientific societies, I couldn't put it on this slide, but I also just want to mention one of her leadership roles in the organization of a very important database resource, which is the Protein Data Bank. And that's quite relevant because what we are thinking is creating kind of a similar data bank for preprints as well, which Jessica will talk about. And Jessica is the executive director of ASAP Bio. She was really one of the original founding group of ASAP Bio and has now moved into this executive directorship role. And she's been heavily involved also in just a number of different efforts involving young scientists with scientific societies. I think one of her major roles was founding a committee at ASCB that is kind of a young scientist committee. And it's really become one of the very vibrant committees at ASCB, and Jessica was responsible for getting that off the ground. So all that to say that all of us are very heavily involved in scientific societies. Now if I figure out how to do this. Okay, so I think obviously two very critical roles that scientific societies are involved with is the exchange of scientific information prior to publication. I mean, this is really, I would say, at the core, one major core of what scientific societies do. This is what scientific meetings are about, what the national meetings are about. They're an opportunity for scientists, you know, to get together and exchange information. And as we'll talk about, I think, you know, preprints are actually a digital extension in many ways of this kind of philosophy. And you know, therefore, we think that the involvement of scientific societies in preprints is going to be extremely important going forward. The other thing that scientific societies, I mean, these are not the only two things they're involved with, but I'm just pointing out the second one as well, that I know all scientific societies think deeply about the careers of young scientists and what they can do to further those careers. And I would say that the route that I got interested in this problem with preprints actually didn't initially come from scholarly communication. It really came from thinking about this problem here, which is the time it's taking young scientists to move through the, you know, entire system to become fully independent. And in fact, we held a two-day retreat when I was AACB president, and one of the major topics was really thinking about this issue about how to promote the careers of young scientists. And obviously, this is, you know, a very complicated problem, but and this is the path that we all know about, but this path is also punctuated by publications. So publications are really kind of a key event that allows individuals to transition, either to get their thesis, to have proof of productivity, to get to a postdoc, to be able to apply for a job, to be able to apply for an R01. So publications are certainly critical for career advancement. But, you know, even though, and this is an analysis that I did for students at UCSF, you know, even though we're living right now in an age where, you know, information transfer can happen extremely rapidly, kind of counterintuitively, a publication, at least, you know, this is a sampling of UCSF graduate students, has been slowing down over time. So this is just analysis of students, I would say, in my era when I was a graduate student versus now. The time to graduation grew a little bit longer, but quite amazingly, just analyzing through PubMed data, the time to first author publication has grown increasingly long, actually to kind of a frightening number, which is the average time. Obviously, there's a big spread to first author publication was 6 years for this at least sampling group. This is the time limit that UCSF sets for graduation. In fact, this is supposed to be, you know, the maximum time, and yet that's the time it's taking on average for students to achieve their first author publication. And also the number of publications over this time has also gone down. So I think there are many factors which were analyzed in that PNAS paper that are causing that trend. But, you know, as a result, you know, the fact that it's taking longer and longer for work that's being produced by our labs to be made public has some consequences, I think, which are undesirable. You know, first of all, that there's just slower dissemination of research results. And probably I think all of us would argue that if you're trying to advance science overall, information is the most catalytic commodity. It's what allows other people to build upon ideas, which is the very nature of the scientific enterprise. And I think a lot of you are probably also seeing this to some extent, that I think there is less and less unpublished information that's being shared at national meetings right now, in part because of the uncertainty of how long it's going to take to get one's research results through a publication pipeline to be made in a publicly available form. So, you know, and this, I would say, is also an undesirable trend. Because these publications are kind of benchmarks for graduation or applying for jobs, there's also, I think it's contributing to longer training periods for students and postdocs. And, you know, just, you know, as a scientist, it's not all about numbers. I think it's also about our culture. And I would say when I was a young student, I looked forward to sending the manuscript out to the journal. It was kind of an exciting time. And I say that now in a group of graduate students, and they laugh because that's not the environment they're experiencing now. It's kind of the moment when they become most fearful almost of what is going to happen, you know, with their paper. And I think we need to return a little bit of this joy in the scholarly communication process back to our profession. Otherwise, I think we're in danger of kind of losing some of the best and brightest minds and attracting them to our profession. I think the key message of our talk today is that, I'll tell you about preprints in a second, I think the room is probably fairly knowledgeable, but we are not talking about an either-or scenario. I think really here, peer review is plays an incredibly important role. All of our papers have benefited to various degrees, but have always benefited through peer review. And it's really not about choosing, it's about embracing both systems for what they have to offer. And, you know, this is, you know, just a diagram of the process I think all of you know very well of what happens with a typical manuscript submission. It goes through this pipeline of editor to peer review. And I think the problem right now is that there is value at the end, that the publication is better, but it's entirely unpredictable. I mean, as a scientist, even nowadays, I have no idea how many journals the work may have to be submitted to. It's also very unpredictable how long it will take. And, you know, therefore, this is where preprints and journals can play a very valuable role. Basically, a preprint in the vast amount of cases is a manuscript that is similar, if not identical, to the manuscript that's being submitted to a journal. And instead of this unpredictable pipeline, the manuscript can be submitted to a preprint server. There's a quality check to make sure that it's scientific in nature. And then that work is posted for the scientific community to review. So while the paper is actually going through the TOP system, it can be made public. Other researchers can benefit from that. And the author also can get feedback on the work that helps improve the final publication. And also to say, relevant for scientific meetings, in many cases, authors now are being contacted for speaking opportunities at scientific meetings based upon what comes out in the preprint rather than the journal. I think all of your scientific societies want to feature kind of more leading edge work at your scientific meetings rather than already published work. So, while peer review is happening, there are a lot of beneficial things that can happen to the through the posting to the scientific community. So, you know, to some extent, this is also not the only issue of scientific publishing that one needs to think about. And I know there are other efforts like, you know, DORA and many other elements of improving peer review that are also worthy. So, we also recognize that we're not saying that this is the only issue in publication to think about, but we think it's potentially both a high impact issue and also a tractable issue as well. I mean, it's wonderful to think of a great idea. One also thinks about its implementation. And I think what we've learned is that we think preprints are feasible, and they're feasible on a near-term timescale. And I think we've even seen that with the amount of progress that's been made in preprints in the past year. Honestly, we would not be talking about preprints as a life science community if it was not also for a 25-year history of, you know, millions of communications going through archive, which Cynthia will talk about. As I said, it addresses many, but certainly not all the current issues in publication. And it's also a springboard for innovation, which I think Jessica will talk about later. And it also is a solution that can operate on a very large timescale. I mean, I think right now coming up with another journal is great, but I think the number of communications that can happen through a single journal are limited. This is something that can coexist with the existing journal system, operate at a very large scale and at low cost. And it's It's actually a dissemination mechanism that is under our control. It's under our control as a scientist. It's a choice that a scientist can make. And it's also something that our scientific community also can take ownership of and also think through the many issues involved with preprints going forward in terms of a potential governance model as well. So I think I'll pass this on now to Cynthia, and she will tell you now a little bit about the more depth about archive and also values of preprints.
Great. All right. Well, thank you very much, and thank you all for being here. So as Ron said, we're not talking about inventing some entirely new model for communicating science. What we're really talking about is replicating a culture of using preprints for scientific communication that has been implemented initially in physics and has expanded to the fields of mathematics, computer science, and a few select other areas, including quantitative biology. So I first want to say why I feel that I have the background to talk about this. So my undergraduate degree is in physics, and I was actually originally planning to go to graduate school in physics too, and made that last minute decision to actually go into biophysics. It was actually during my time as an undergraduate at Cornell that I met Paul Ginsparg, who was then a graduate student and became the founder of the archive. And I was in touch with Paul actually while I was a graduate student and through other friends in the physics field. And so I knew about the archive from its inception and how it grew among physicists. I then, around the same time, married a mathematician, and the mathematicians soon thereafter embraced the use of preprints as well. So I've been living with someone now for 27 years who has been posting preprints on the archive and talking about it. And we used to talk about the archive, and at first I thought, well, biologists don't really need preprints the way you guys do because things are working okay in scientific communication. But as Ron has already outlined, things are not really okay. There are a lot of problems that could be addressed by preprints, but also really the culture of preprints has made physics, I think, a very vibrant field and has facilitated the exchange of information in a beneficial way. So really for most physicists and mathematicians, their scholarly publication begins with a preprint. They write a manuscript and they deposit on the archive where it is immediately available for everyone to see. And the statistic I show here, this is just a screenshot from the archive page from a couple of days ago, at which point there were over 1.23 million preprints that had already been deposited in the archive. So the archive started out as a repository for preprints in the high-energy physics field, and it gradually took over more and more areas of physics. I took this off the archive website and tried to break it down, but what you could see is so there are an enormous number of papers from physics. It was embraced by mathematics. That's the magenta part of this. And actually, computer science has embraced this, as well as actually finance, statistics, and biology here, specifically quantitative biology. And there are sections for all of these in the archive. And at this point, there is something on the order of 110,000 depositions per year of preprints that are in the archive. So how are preprints used in these fields? So as Ron said, it's early communication of results. You write your paper, it is now up there and available. It is instantly, essentially published for the world to see. People know that it's not a peer-reviewed publication, but it's an opportunity to put your work out there and to get feedback on your results prior to publication. And this very commonly occurs in physics, in mathematics, where someone finds an error in your proof and communicates with you and you fix it. I know in the physics field, there are areas of physics where they just, like, they get up in the morning and they look at the new papers that have been released on the archive to find out about the latest results that have been posted there. And so it really accelerates the pace of discovery. And this is a figure here, I believe, yeah, it comes from Nature, which came right after the experiments of the Large Hadron Collider, reporting perhaps the detection of the Higgs boson. And it says here in 21 days, physicists posted 150 papers on the archive preprint server reporting their own results about the Higgs boson. So this really, you didn't have to wait a year or 18 months for someone to finish the experiments, write the paper, get it peer-reviewed, get it published in these journals. This was available instantly and available to the whole world. So not just insiders, not just people who can afford to go to meetings where there are top speakers, where they get a chance to interact with them. Everybody. It's very democratic, and it's open to all, and it reaches many more people, right? Because it's all you need is a computer and internet service. So other ways in which preprints are used. So preprints in these fields establishes priority. When you post your preprint, it has a permanent identifier, it has a timestamp, and it is your publication, it is your report of your results. And I often, for any of you who may know about the CRISPR story, there was a Virginia Sixness, I hope I spelled that correctly, in Vilna, where I'm forgetting now, not Ukraine, I don't remember now, Eastern Europe. But he, in fact, had made some of the same advances as Dowden and Charpentier, but submitted his paper early, but had a lot more trouble publishing his paper than those people. And this, he's being recognized now for his contribution, but in fact he was beaten into publication not because he didn't write the paper first, but because it didn't get accepted first. So in these fields also, posting a preprint is evidence of progress. You can report it in your NSF grant, it can be in your progress report, it can be in your biosketch. It is I forget the term they have for it, there's a scientific product. A preprint is a scientific product. It's used in hiring and promotion CVs. You just have a separate section for preprints. People know that a preprint is not a peer-reviewed publication, but they also know it's not manuscript in preparation. There's a real manuscript there, and anyone can go there and read it, should they choose so. And it's used in postdoctoral applications. So again, in the job search project, progress for more junior people. It is also citable and routinely cited. And just to bring you an example, while I was working on this presentation a couple of days ago, I just went online and I said, I'll go to Science. I know they publish papers by physicists. I found a paper by a physicist, and I just searched for the word archive. And these are the two citations here, just in that one randomly selected paper to preprints. You find them all the time in papers in physics and mathematics and computer science. Now, even though when they established the preprint server, I know Paul Ginspark has said that they thought that this might mean the demise of journals, and journals perhaps worried that it would be the demise of journals, but that's actually not been the case at all. Preprints continue to coexist with peer-reviewed journals in all of these fields. I guess I don't know for sure with computer science, but I'm pretty sure computer scientists publish their results a little differently in conference proceedings. But they have continued to coexist. So it has not threatened the existence of journals, and they have had a role for both the communication as a preprint as well as peer review. The fact is that the vast majority of these papers end up in peer-reviewed journals. I know there was an analysis of papers, citations in high-energy physics, and over the time period 2004 to 2014, 80% of the preprints ended up having journal citations. So these are, by and large, papers that end up in the conventional literature. So one of the biggest concerns I hear articulated by biologists is that preprints will increase the risk of junk publications. So first of all preprints are screened. They're all screened by the archive for obvious inappropriate submissions. So it's got to look like a real manuscript by real scientists or mathematicians that makes sense. So what prevents individual scientists from posting crap? I hear that a lot too. And what Paul has told us is that your reputation is at stake. If you're posting completely garbage paper, you've just put your name out there on a piece of junk. Similarly, if you just post minimally publishable units, as we call them. So first of all, people post and publish MPUs all the time in standard journals, frankly, breaking up a study into bite-sized pieces to expand your number of publications. But there's really no difference with preprints versus the literature. Now, the supposition in physics and math is that it isn't having a preprint posted that is the benefit to you. It is the contents of your preprint. And this is really important. Nobody cares if you posted 10 preprints. They don't sit there in the room evaluating you for promotion and say, oh, he just posted 10 preprints. They read the preprints and they decide if the contents of any of those manuscripts is what makes you worthy of promotion or whatever the base, whatever they're evaluating you for. And again, what the fact that it's not peer-reviewed, which is another concern I hear articulated, the community knows it's not peer-reviewed, just as they know that the unpublished results you present at a meeting are not peer-reviewed, just as they know that the preliminary data you put in your NIH grant is not peer-reviewed, and they just assess it as such. Now, I think one also has to ask in considering this question, do journals increase the risk of junk publication? There is, and I'm not pointing fingers if any of you are involved in your society journals, but we all know, sadly, that the fact that something does have the stamp of peer review doesn't mean that it's great science, that it's valid science, or that it's reproducible science. And these are a few snapshots of, you know, some of the more notorious cases. So we know about the, you know, the autism causes, the vaccines causing autism research, which is a terrible publication that actually caused a lot of harm. There have been papers that have actually languished for years in the literature and have not even been retracted, even though everyone knows there's a problem because of various issues with the process of forcing a retraction and getting the authors to agree with that. So another thing that arises, I hear people say, well, but physics is different from biology. I would say no, physics is not different from biology. There really are far more commonalities than differences. They are either theoretical or experimental scientists. Someone told me, well, their experiments are not as expensive to replicate. Well, you know what? A lot of their experiments are way more expensive to carry out than our experiments. There's not that issue with them at all. We have many similarities. We can benefit in the same way they've benefited from rapid communication, opportunity to show progress, getting feedback on publications, and again, placing the emphasis again on the contents of what is posted rather than where it is posted. It's been very interesting, even for myself, you know, being as a biologist, seeing papers now. I see a tweet about a paper, and it's been posted on the BioArchive, which is an archive set up, one of the repositories for biologists. And I really find myself thinking, oh, that's a cool result. And I want to know where it's been published. And I realize you don't think about that at all. It's just up there for you to read and look and assess the science on your own, which I think would be a fantastic thing for us. I think, as in physics, peer review is going to survive. We will have peer review journals. Maybe peer review will evolve. But just as in physics and mathematics in those fields, it will survive and I think flourish if we all embrace preprints. So there have always been preprint-friendly journals for biologists because, for example, journals like Science and Nature publish paper by physicists, so they have been preprint-friendly from the get-go. But there's a growing list of journals now that biologists publish in that also allow authors to post their work as preprints and will still accept the work for publication or even sometimes solicit papers based on preprints that they've seen posted. So anyway, I will stop there. So I would like to hand the microphone over now to Jessica, who will talk with us more about preprints and preprint servers and how we move forward.
Thank you, Cynthia. And hello to everyone, and also hello to those of you who are watching by video conference. Thank you so much for joining us. I just want to give a bit of background about ASAP Bio and a new development that we're involved with that I hope will be an opportunity for more collaboration with societies. So ASAP Bio is originally a small group of biologists who wanted to discuss how preprints could play a role in the life sciences. Our first meeting was held at HHMI a little over a year ago. We brought together stakeholders from journals, funding agencies, junior and senior scientists, and reached the conclusion at this meeting that there was a sort of broad consensus that preprints could play a role in addition to the journal system. Since that time, we have been working with a variety of stakeholders to support policy changes, to consolidate information, and to hopefully create culture change among different elements of the enterprise. Through this process, we have been thinking about how preprints can best serve scientists and other stakeholders in this enterprise. We feel that it's important that preprints are first easy to find, stably preserved, that they are all according to agreed upon standards, so that they behave in certain expected ways, and that they're available for reuse, particularly by parties who may be interested in text and data mining, but also applications that I'll talk about in just a moment. And finally, we feel that preprints should be governed by the community in terms of their standards. And we believe that the infrastructure that supports preprints should be really treating them as a public good. Now, one challenge to achieving these aims is that preprints in biology are currently fragmented across many different sources. For example, there's been a long history of preprints on archive. And there's also many other servers that cater, in many cases, specifically to biology, most notably BioArchive. But in addition to this, there's also other services that are outside of the traditional domain of biology. ChemArchive, which you'll hear about a little bit later today, as well as several servers for agriculture, psychology, sociology.
Then I'll be...
And actually, just yesterday, Cielo, which is a Latin American repository, just announced that they're also going to be developing a preprint service. So here we see examples of different communities with different needs, different scopes of work, different interests entering the preprint space. And we think this is a really great opportunity for innovation. You know, there are many different ways of both collecting preprints and of displaying them, of hosting commentary services, et cetera. And so a variety of preprint sources will enable this kind of innovation to flourish. So there's a lot of information on this slide. I don't intend for you to read all of it, but our question is, in physics, Cynthia has told you about how having the single destination for preprints has made it very easy for scientists to keep up with developments. With this diversity of servers that we see in biology, can we reap some of the same benefits of preprints that are easy to find? Impression that there is a source that is trusted to have preprints within the appropriate scope, but also encourage innovation. We conducted a survey asking whether it is better to have one or multiple servers. And interestingly, we got responses all across the board. Many people said, you know, don't dilute this. It's better to have one. I want a vetted place where I know it can find and trust preprint articles. That multiple servers would lead to confusion. Others said that a single server is a single point of failure. Different communities have different publishing cultures. Competition is a good thing. And many people were in the middle saying, for example, it doesn't matter either way as long as they have similar operating principles. A meta server would be best. And it doesn't matter as long as they're searchable. So this survey, as well as other conversations at a funders workshop held at NIH last May, consultations with existing preprint servers, and a technical workshop last August, led us to develop and iterate on this idea of a common database for the full text of preprints that we have described in a recent RFA, which came out last week. So briefly, I'm missing some icons here, but you'll have to use your imagination. So the notion here is that a central service could function as a common database where preprints from multiple sources could flow into one full text archive. And here they can be stably preserved and also sent to different applications by APIs or bulk downloads. So for example, there would be a place for scientists to search for preprints, an opportunity to download the entire corpus for text mining, the ability to produce annotation services and discussion services. And importantly, the guidelines for inclusion into this database and the standard formats could be governed by a community governance body of biologists and other life sciences. So just to give you a taste for what this annotation could look like. This is actually a very, very recent, this is about 4 hours old, but there's now a pilot at Europe PubMed Central of BioArchive preprints on Europe PMC. So what they've done is they've taken BioArchive preprints that are licensed under Creative Commons licenses, transformed them into HTML, through XML. And now you can actually search for them on EuroPMC. In addition to actually finding them, you can annotate them with this tool called SciLight. And what this does is it will highlight gene ontology, genes, proteins, and organisms, and you can click on these names as they appear in the full text and bring up additional search resources. So this is a demonstration of how preprints moving beyond the PDF can add additional functionality. For discussion, I think I'd like to return to Ron's point that this is really the, you know, in the expert domain of scientific societies, that scientific societies lead communities of scientists who have the exact kind of discussions that we would might hope would happen around preprints at poster sessions and at talks at meetings. And so we hope that this could be an opportunity for bringing more readers to preprints to enrich the experience for authors and all scientists. So I won't elaborate too much on the what the functions of the central service would be. I've already told you that it would function like a search engine, but that it would also aggregate the full text of content. And this is important both for the preservation of content and also so that it can be sent out to for text mining and for other forms of reuse like the ones that I've just told you about. We also are interested in providing open source software tools for manuscript conversion from authors' formats into XML and HTML-based formats so that the enrichments like the SciLight tool that you just saw can be enabled on the large scale. And also, as the volume of manuscripts grows, we will need automated ways of highlighting manuscripts for additional screening. And importantly, I want to return again to the idea that the standards, we believe, should be led by a community-led governance body, which is another area that scientific societies, I think, could play a major role in informing. So we announced last Monday that 11 funding agencies had announced their support for the principles behind a service like this. So these are essentially guiding principles such as openness, governance, et cetera, that are covered in this document here at asapbio.org/principles. And we have more information related to this release in a recent newsletter. But I want to share with you this morning some news that we are announcing here at this meeting, which is that we have received a $1 million grant from the Helmsley Trust. This generous contribution will help us to initiate the central service and will catalyze the development of this governance body and some of these early services. So with that, I'm very excited to hear your reactions, thoughts, and questions. Briefly before we move to questions, if we could move around the table and do brief introductions. If you would also mind using your microphone as this is being recorded and we're on a video conference. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Daniel Salisbury with PNAS.
Diane Sullenberger with PNAS.
Barbara Goldman, Journalist Director of ASM.
Mary Rose Franco, the Health Research Alliance.
Rita Sheeman, American Physiological Society.
Christina Bennett, American Physiological Society.
Rebecca Ostis, American Physiological Society.
Neil Thacker from NIH.
Blythe Alexander, Society for Neuroscience.
Yvette Seeger, FASAB.
Jennifer Pessinelli, FASAB.
Rich Dodenhoff, Journals Director for the American Society for Pharmacology and Experimental Therapeutics.
I'm David Nelson, Editor-in-Chief of American Journal of Human Genetics and a professor at Baylor College of Medicine.
Sarah Cullinan, American Journal of Human Genetics.
Joe McInerney, American Society of Human Genetics.
Janine Chiap.
Nick Shockey from Spark.
Marcia Lucas, Society for Developmental Biology.
Elizabeth Austin, American Association of Anatomists.
Barbara Jasny, Science Magazine and AAAS.
Kathy Giffey, Wiley. Darla Henderson with the American Chemical Society.
Stefano Bertuzzi, CEO, American Society for Microbiology.
Erica Shugart, Executive Director, American Society for Cell Biology.
Kevin Wilson, American Society for Cell Biology.
With Rescuing Biomedical Research.
David Malikoff from the News Staff at Science.
Rachel Allen-Zack, News Staff at Science.
Is that everyone?
No.
Oh, hi.
Okay. Ben Korb, American Society for Biochemistry and Molecular Biology.
Okay, well, we do have, we'll have lots of time for questions as we go throughout the day, but we can take a few moments for discussion right now, if you'd like, before Neil's talk.
So my question has to do with, you say that I have not gone to a server, a preprint server, or looked at it or anything yet, but it's open to everyone. So what happens, or has anything like this happened where a member of the press has gone in, looked at a preprint, started tweeting about it, started writing about it, and it hasn't been clear, they don't make it clear that this is not peer-reviewed. Has anything like that ever happened? Or what do you do or think about that?
I'm sorry I don't have references with me, but so I've actually seen recent news pieces, and I forget if it was in Science or Nature, which talked about some new advances. I believe it was in the field of astrophysics and discussing a preprint and explicitly referring to the fact that it was a preprint posted in the archive that they were covering.
I mean, maybe this is a question just sort of for discussion, but do we think this is, like, just the general public is going to understand what that means? Like, what is a preprint?
I think that current preprint servers in biology, specifically BioArchive, PeerJ preprints, and also it's been added to EuropeMC in this pilot for preprints. There's a disclaimer at the top which says explicitly this is a preprint, and there's a way to click and find more information about that. I do agree that it's extremely important that there is transparency about how peer review has not been conducted on these manuscripts. I certainly hope that, the question of how they're covered in the press is really important, and we are hoping to engage with journalists to a greater extent in the future.
An interesting side note to this. There was a blog post, I think, came out Monday or yesterday from a group of researchers, and they tracked a sample of NCI-funded cancer studies and the mentions in the press, and they found that 60% of the articles that were the source for these press articles were behind paywalls. So on the other side, there's also, I think, some issues too.
Also to say, I think this is an area you're pointing out to. It does require more thought and clarity. I think it's issues like this that, again, having a governance body, represented from the scientific community can really also help actually to articulate points and guidelines for, the best ways of informing the press and so forth. So I think the area you touched on and many others is actually a good reason also why having a governance body going forward for preprints is going to be very valuable. That said, also, there is an opportunity for a lot of self-correction to occur within the community before an article becomes public. So, I think Cynthia brought up some cases where, there were really problematic publications that would have been likely corrected by the scientific community before they went to press. And this happens in archive all the time. There are, many cases where communication comes out and it's almost self-corrected in real time before it reaches a problematic point much later. One other thing to say, and authors need to be aware of this, a lot of journals In many cases, an author submits to a preprint server and a journal at the same time, and the journals have very strict guidelines of embargo policies and kind of author interactions with the press, which many of those cases prohibit the author, while it's under review at that journal, from soliciting press coverage. Now, that said, you know, a very informed member of the press can find something in a preprint server and cover it without that author being involved in it. But there are embargo policies in place, you know, between the submitting author and the press that they will have to abide by.
A practice of commenting at meetings that I'm also covering. But since I am a working member of the press and people may not be aware of how this works, I just wanted to throw out a couple of pieces of information. One is most journalists are not aware that preprints exist unless they are brought to their attention by the scientist or the institution. So the vast majority of journalists have no idea this world even exists. Among the small population of science journalists who cover science routinely, preprints are routinely covered. I would point out, however, that preprints, in a sense, are no different than talks at publicly accessible meetings, and we also cover talks at meetings, and almost all of that material has not gone through peer review either. And the long practice is, if you're speaking at a public meeting, that presentation can be covered by the press. If it involves material that you're submitting to a journal, the journals typically ask you, if you're talking to the journalist who's covering the meeting, not to go beyond what is in your slides. Right, so that's the general practice in that area. So I just offer that as a point of information.
Thank you.
Coming in from the microbiology perspective, I would encourage, Jessica, you mentioned the governance that will think about this issue, to really include in your governance process someone who comes in with a microbiology perspective. The reason I'm making that is not territorial, is simply because there are some very specific cases which I think are very special, what I'm referring to is a dual use research of concern. And I remember when Paul Ginsberg addressed it, there was something coming along this line. He treated it a little bit cavalierly. And I understand that, you know, no one can set up, you know, gravitational wave detectors in their backyard, but someone could, you know, use very dangerous pathogens made up in the garage, and so NIH has spent how many years, Neil, dealing with the issue of dual use research of concern, and I think that this is something that you need to be very aware of. It doesn't mean that that it's impossible. I'm just saying, make sure that you think about this issue. It's very relevant and special to biology and virology, microbiology in particular.
I actually have a comment to make on the press and stuff, and then I have a question. But it just occurs to me that if done well, that could be an opportunity to explain the peer review process, which the public doesn't know anyway. So adding in this extra component might help to make the public more science literate. My question would be, so the potential for feedback and improving the science within the preprints before it gets to publication, how much does that actually happen in the biology? Because I think I read somewhere that bioarchive preprints have maybe 10% commenting on them, mm-hmm. So that doesn't seem like a lot.
I could just speak from recent personal experience. I posted a preprint with collaborators the first version at the end of last year. We decided to wait a little bit before submitting to a journal, and we didn't get any public comments, but we got an incredibly thoughtful response from a colleague by email who sent us private comments. We actually then revised the paper and put up a new version on bioarchive even before submitting to a journal. So for me personally, this has been a really helpful process to improve the quality of the product that gets sent to journals in the first place. But
so do you think there's more private commenting happening than we can see on the, okay.
Yeah, I could also say archive has no commenting. So it's made a very conscious decision not to have a commenting system as part of their website and product. That, you know, their philosophy is they're a neutral server.
They're just relaying information. And yet, obviously, in the physics community over years, there's a tremendous amount of, you know, scientific exchange and interaction that's happening kind of directly between scientists. And I also agree with my experiences with preprints as well. Actually, most of the best, I think what you see in terms of commenting is the very tip of the iceberg that's going on. And it also allows the author to take initiative on commenting as well. I mean, you can send, it's a public document, you can send it to a colleague whose opinion you value to get feedback. So, yes, I think what's happening in practice right now is that beyond the bioarchive commenting, there's a lot of interactions getting back to authors, probably, which will only increase, you know, as familiarity with, you know, preprints increases. I think that exchange of, you know, information directly to the author is going to increase as well.
So I'll just comment as someone who's followed archive for a very long time. Many of the points are exactly right. I'd like to add to a few others. Archive serves as the main, for the community as a main discovery tool because it aggregates content across journals. So, you know, in the health sciences, you have NLM and PubMed and so forth. In the physical science, there isn't an equivalent indexing service. So the archive has been a very valuable discovery tool, and I think there's a lot of, I think there's a couple studies that show that papers posted on archive are cited more than papers that are not, and it's really because of that discovery. No one makes people post on the archive. Some people post when it's submitted. Some people post when papers are accepted. So for issues like clinical trials, I mean, one could have a culture that certain types of studies should only be posted, or the community might recommend that certain types of studies with broad health implications or whatever maybe should only be posted at a certain time. That's a cultural thing. The last thing on the comment and reply is actually archive is considering a variety of commenting and most more probably annotation services than commenting and reply. They've been considering that for a couple of years. One thing we have found is while there isn't a commenting function, because anybody can post a paper on archive, it often obviates or replaces or makes moot the formal comment and reply process in a journal because things can happen much faster on the archive than they can through the peer review process and the more clunky. I think all of us who are journal publishers or editors recognize that our own comment and reply process is probably the slowest part of our editorial process. And what we have found is that things can move at very much more rapid speed on the archive, and then you can have a comment, reply, a reply to the comment, or reply to the reply, or reply to the reply. Anyway, and all of that can happen much faster than as editors you could actually deal with the comment reply system. So just one nuance there.
So thank you so much for your questions and comments. We would now like to welcome Neil Thacker from the NIH to give us a funder perspective on preprints. And at the end of the program, we'll have much more time for discussion as well. So.
Thank you. So as you probably have been guessing, NIH has been involved in a discussion with lots of stakeholders in lots of different ways about preprints and other kinds of interim products. And I want to talk to you about an RFI that we issued and some of the results that we got and where our thinking is right now. So we haven't made up our mind about anything, but there are a few ideas that have emerged from these discussions that I'd like to get your feedback on. And if we don't have time to get your thoughts to me today, because I do have to leave a little bit early, feel free to email me afterwards. We really are in an open discussion phase inside NIH. So just to put this in context, whereas NIH is still thinking about this stuff very hard, there's been some clear signals from some funders, including HHMI, Medical Research Council, Wellcome Trust, that they're counting preprints as evidence of productivity in their internal processes. And we're thinking about things along those same lines and how we might do that. So we are interested in doing this. And right now, our current rules are a little bit confusing. So you, when you apply to NIH for funding, you can put together a research proposal. You can say, here's my preliminary data, here's the study I plan to do, and you can cite materials to support those arguments, and you can cite whatever you want. But when it comes time to claiming credit for the work that you did on previous NIH grants, or you describe in a biosketch the work that you've done, our rules technically don't allow you to claim a preprint. So you can't say, with the last NIH grant you got me, I wrote a preprint. Or you can't say, in my biosketch, I've done work in the following areas, and here's a preprint describing that. So there's a bit of a disconnect there. We also have been hearing these discussions from this group and from other groups that there's some scientific potential here to advance science. And so what we want to do is to recognize standing practices in many of the disciplines we already fund to allow preprints, and we want to encourage innovation if there is innovation to be had to make science faster, more rigorous, more accessible. So we want to have rules that allow disciplines to adopt preprints at their own pace. And if there are scientific disciplines who aren't comfortable with preprints, it could be because of the sensitive nature of the research and the implications on human health, as you just mentioned, Brooke. Maybe they just choose not to move in that direction, and that could be okay. Or maybe there's another discipline that thinks this really makes sense for the kind of work we do, and they want to move quickly. And if we can have rules that support that, that would be great. And we don't want to prevent any kind of innovation that could improve dissemination or enhance rigor. And some of the commenting things that you've talked about, we do see as a potential to enhance rigor, because scientists can modify their work before things are set in stone. And we're also concerned about stopping any bad practices from taking root, or sort of nipping these practices in the bud as these norms are being established. So, for example, we're very concerned about a scholarly record which is not permanent. We don't want people putting things on their laboratory webpage, for example, calling it a preprint, citing it in grant, it could get cited in papers, and then, you know, 5 years later, the document disappears. That's absolutely, I think, a bad outcome. And so we want to make sure that if we do move in this direction, our rules are clear enough to prevent that sort of thing from happening. So we are thinking about preprints. This discussion is really focused on preprints, but there are other spaces and other discussions which capture similar kinds of logic. So when we think about complete and public products that are not final, and so, for example, this presentation is complete, it's public, but it's not final in the sense that everything I'm talking about is still under deliberation. So we would call this an interim research product or an interim policy product. And we came up with this umbrella term because it captures preprints, which we're defining as complete and public drafts of scientific documents, and other things like pre-registration of protocols, where you publicly declare an element of your research study in advance. And we think this may be an important way to reduce some of the biases that we're seeing emerge, or we're becoming more aware of. So we issued an RFI, and we asked for feedback on this general concept of interim research product. We got about 350 responses and some really, really interesting feedback. And so some of you supplied feedback. We read it. I personally enjoyed reading all of them because it gave me a great sense of what people are thinking. One of the main questions we asked is, what do you think the impacts are of these kinds of products and encouraging their use? And the most common comment, and you may not be able to see it, is speed dissemination. Almost everyone said they would speed dissemination. And this is really that 9-month average time from submitting an article to an article being published that we can sort of move aside if we can get those findings out sooner. So there was that important finding. And then the second most common comment was, overall, people thought this was a good thing. And there were special call-outs for this idea that people would engage in collaboration with or comments with the community, that would get feedback on their paper that would make it better, that it could help advance junior scientists in the way that Ron was describing. And it could help with the timing of things because you can't control the timing of a publication, but you can control the timing of a preprint. And if you have a particular document or application, where that information would really help if it was available publicly, it can be useful in that area. But there were also a handful of unsupportive comments, a small number, but very thoughtful. And they were primarily focused on some of the risks that may be involved in having placing greater emphasis on information that isn't peer-reviewed. And so there's the idea that this stuff isn't peer-reviewed and therefore it's not reliable, that it could be misused by the public, that having non-peer-reviewed information and bringing that into our review processes is going to just create extra work for everyone and more confusion. And so we're also thinking about those things too. But overall, most people were thoughtful. So with those caveats in mind, I think the RFI is telling us that they're at least the people who responded see some benefit in allowing interim products to play a greater role within the NIH process. So rather simple conclusion, but then how do we implement it in our complex set of rules? And it's a little bit complicated. So how should they be cited? How should reviewers handle them? What do we actually call these things? How do we operationalize this? And so I'm going to go through some of these considerations. And again, these are considerations. We're still thinking them through. And the first thing is we want to have citation requirements. So people who are looking at a citation know they're looking at a preprint. And basically, there are three things that we would like to see in a citation, we think. And one is a digital object identifier, or a DOI. And this is one way of us getting at the idea that a preprint is something of a permanent document. It's not by any means a guarantee, but it's a little bit better than here's a URL to my lab page. We also want a listing of an object type. Several of our commenters actually suggested any citation that says preprint of a preprint should say not peer-reviewed in the citation. And of course, one of the challenges is we have lots of documents that are cited all the time in science that aren't peer-reviewed, and we don't call them out. So I think if we just say this is a preprint or this is a protocol, we can start to get to that sense of conveying the quality of the information or the quality of the review. And then we're also very interested in versioning. We want to know when someone is citing something, are they citing, you know, the preprint from last month or the revision this month or some future version? And so there's a versioning thing. And then also in science, we have a fairly established convention now of you citing the date where you actually read the document. And that's a little complicated because when you're writing a bio sketch or a CV or something like that, you're not citing yourself for reference for a point. You're just claiming it as a credit for credit. And so the version becomes important. And we want to make sure that's there. So those are the things we're thinking about just for the citation format. On top of that, there are a bunch of things that we are thinking about asking awardees to use if they want to cite these things as products of their NIH work. And so we talked about a DOI. On the document itself, in the text, there are a number of things we might want to ask for, like a statement that this is not peer-reviewed, a declaration of competing interests, and adherence with all these other NIH rules and policies. Dual use was one example. You know, you can't use NIH funds to lobby and so forth. And so all of the things that publishers do aside from peer review that enhance the rigor of the scholarly record, and acknowledgments of competing interests is a great example. We want those things to happen too in the preprint process. And then the other thing I wanted to highlight for you guys is we're thinking about asking the papers that arise from NIH funds or preprints that arise from NIH funds would be available on a Creative Commons by attribution license. And the idea here is that we want to make sure that if NIH is paying for these preprints, that these preprints are as accessible as possible and as open as possible to whatever the technologies are now and the technologies are in the future. And of course, one of the challenges we have, especially in this space, is that the technology and the infrastructure is moving far faster than our policies ever could. And, you know, we're trying to think about how we may want things to work in the future. So the other reason why we're talking about this now before we've made up our minds is because we recognize how quickly things are moving, and we want to engage with all of these current and potential repositories before their practices get set in stone and before scientific communities fix their standards. So we're thinking of highlighting some potential best practices for repositories, and these would include the FAIR principles, you know, that things are findable and accessible and so forth, that the metadata are open, so NIH doesn't have to go through some very complicated things to find out what preprints are being written with NIH funds or how these preprints are being used, that these materials are machine accessible, that the repository has transparent policies on what their rules are for plagiarism and competing interests and other kinds of ethics policies, that they have clear rigor versioning processes, especially linking to the final published version, if there is one, and ways to track changes in the documents if these things go through multiple versions. And then some kind of archival plan, because again, we don't want these things to disappear, and then we have a bunch of dead references in our scholarly record. So that's a lot of stuff, and I'm hoping to get a lot of feedback on that. I'm just going to keep going forward, and then we can talk about whatever seems the most interesting to you all. So the next question is, even though we allow preprints in our reference section, I think there's some recognition that if we were to encourage, if we were to allow preprints to be counted as products of an award, we may be creating a bit of an incentive to create more preprints, and then we'll see more preprints in the reference section, and then this becomes something that most reviewers have to think about. And so how should preprints be included in the review process? What role should they play? And again, overall, most people were supportive that it should play some role in the preprint, in the review process for NIH funds. And there were also a handful of people that had some very thoughtful concerns about why it shouldn't. Most of the concerns were, again, the same reasons that happened for science overall, that you're introducing things that aren't peer-reviewed into review, and that can create extra work for reviewers and potentially throw them off. But on the pro side, we also had the same arguments that we saw for science in general, that you have the opportunity to move quicker, you have the opportunity to support people who are earlier in their career, and these risks tend to offset the these benefits tended to offset the risks. And so, you know, everyone recognized that these aren't peer review and that the quality of information from a preprint is probably not as good as the quality of information from a peer review paper. And then the general advice was reviewers should take that into account and they should look at the information in the document itself before making an assessment, which is, I think, a great principle. But in practice, when you're talking about potentially hundreds of citations in an application and the pressures the reviewers are under, it's a very challenging thing to do. So what we're thinking about is, again, allowing people to cite these products in progress reports, in biosketches, using these citation formats, and then also using these citation formats in the reference section. But recognizing that it does create this question of how reviewers should handle this. So we asked, how should reviewers handle this? What should we tell reviewers? And they gave us a lot of advice. And basically, I think what it comes down to is that we need to have very clear definitions of what these things are for both reviewers and applicants. We have to make it clear that reviewers understand these documents aren't peer-reviewed. And we have to make it clear to both the reviewers and the applicants that the reviewers aren't under any obligation to read references. And we'll just be upfront, and we'll let science move in the way it's going to move. So that's where we are right now. That's what we're thinking about. Overall, I you know, the feedback we've gotten so far is that these interim products are a good thing, and we should encourage their use. But I wanted to call out a couple of things, especially because I think your feedback would be especially important. And one is this Creative Commons by attribution requirement. and then making sure repositories or encouraging repositories to make content permanent, protect reviewer privacy, all of these things that we need to enhance some integrity in this line of scholarship. So we want to move fast because we are concerned that disciplines and repositories will establish practices that will then turn out to be not something that NIH can support. But on the other hand, we recognize this is enormously complex, and anytime we mess with the rules for applications and instructions for reviewers, it's very complicated and it's easy to do things in a confusing way. So that's why we're talking about this as it's all under consideration. And we'll probably put out a blog trying to lay this all out about the things we're thinking about and find a way to test and get some guidance on the specific implementation paths for whatever direction we decide to go in. So those are the main points of where we are, and I would love to hear your comments, both now and after the meeting. Thank you. Yes.
So one of the things I would encourage, I did like the fact that you put up versioning, and you're really thinking about versioning, because we've been allowing in our journal citation of preprints for a while, and one of the things we're probably about to roll out is a requirement to cite the version as well, because you know a lot of the comments are not, as it's been observed, are not out on BioArchive, so you're not really, you know, unless you're sort of indicating which is that notable record, I think there could be some issues here, and it would also then encourage, of course, people to do the versioning, which is a good thing to do as well, so you have that sort of openness and clarity of kind of how that science has changed on the servers as you might have gotten private comments back.
So I have a question about what the thinking is behind requiring the most liberal Creative Commons license, since the goal of having the content available and open can be met with something that protects the author's rights a little bit more.
That's a great question, and that's something we've been talking about. So we've been framing this as an internal discussion about how to advance science and fix the problems that we're seeing in scholarly communication today. But there are some larger issues that we haven't touched on. And so Ron has been talking about the big issues about career progression and how that's slowing down. But if you look at publication over time, we know that scholars can only read a fraction of the material that's put out in their field. And one of the ways that they manage this information is by specializing. And then when you're specialized, you have to collaborate with more and more people to do meaningful work. And if you also look over time, you'll see that the number of authors on your typical biomedical paper has been increasing over time. And so we've been accounting for our great success in research in a very positive way, but all of these collaborations come with a productivity cost. All of our ability to read has a productivity cost, and we are slowly becoming, in some measures, less and less productive in our scope, in our ability to impact all this information. We need another solution to do this, and one way to do that is to open up this information to get this stuff out so not only can machines read this stuff, but so we can get investment into this area to develop the new technologies that people need so they can stay up to for the literature. If we're thinking about papers as we're writing for a human, the human's going to read it, and that's our audience, that's great. I don't think we need these anything more than a person, you know, a fair use kind of license. But if we're thinking about something for the future, we need something broader. And it's interesting, you can think about, like, for example, high-speed rail, for example. In the United States, it's very difficult to do that. We have the technology, there are high-speed trains in other parts of the world, but in the United States, because of the way our financing works, because of our policy, because of our property rights, it's really hard to apply that technology. And so we want to make sure that we have a corpus of literature that people can come in and apply that technology and do all kinds of innovative things. And that's where the Creative Commons by Attribution license comes in. It's the most open for those kinds of future uses. And again, you know, if we were to do this, it would only be for papers arising from NIH funds. It wouldn't be for all preprints. Yes.
Yes, I just wanted to comment that from my perspective and my part of the community, I think that requirement of any one specific license is going to be limiting to the authors and an author's participation. So what you might see are NIH authors not actually participating as much because they feel that their future rights might be more limited. Why not go for a license that would protect the author and any society publisher and other publishers from commercial competition and the creation of derivative works? I think, you know, our big challenge is affecting a cultural change and bringing that about. The primary concern is getting that participation and letting, you know, having something that's demonstrable while protecting the author's rights.
So that's a really good point, and you're right. It could be that authors, some authors choose not to make certain things available as preprints because there are certain rights that they want to protect. They think that there's a commercial application to the document, or they're worried about it could be translated or somehow misappropriated, and they choose not to issue a preprint. And that is the downside. You said something interesting about scientific society rights. So if I write a preprint, what's the commercial interest of the repository?
Well, we've talked a little bit about how the preprint then later on becomes an article and how important that peer review process is. And around the table you have societies, many of whom are also publishers or representative of society publishers. And so that is a piece of the puzzle that I think you will hear a lot of concern from the society, as well as, quite frankly, from my author base. They are not yet willing. We have probably about a quarter of our open access content being purchased under CC BY, which indicates preferences for other models.
I'd also like to comment and follow up on what Darrell's saying. And I had this conversation already with Jessica, and also she mentioned in the last part of her talk, which relates to what you're saying now, Neil, I also have concern about CC BY type of licensing, precisely for the last thing that Valerie just mentioned, is if these are interim research product, which I love that term that you use at NIH, I think it captures essentially what it is. I think that building restrictions essentially on what the authors need to do in order to be indexed in the central service, it goes a little bit against the grain. So imposing a CC BY licensing would limit what the author wants to do with that paper afterwards. And we'll limit the publisher as well. So
how would it limit the author and publisher about future
limit the author
versions?
Because the author may want to, out of that publication, do have some derivative products out of it that wouldn't be protected anymore. And these are things that they may not be evident to the authors when they submit that. So my approach is why not. Making sure that preprints do the wonderful thing that they can do, which is be nimble and be out fast and be available. But all these secondary requirements seem to me a little bit of a mission creep, honestly. And I see a big role instead in that for the peer-reviewed publication.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to insert one comment about the previous speaker. I'm sorry, terrible with names. I would not take as a measure of author support how many choose the open access option. I can tell you that over the years, when I was feeling pinched for money, I did not spring the extra few thousand dollars for the open access option, even though I really wanted to do that for all my papers, because none of the people who fund me give me extra money for open access. So I don't think that that's a measure at all of author support.
And specifically, I was talking about within the open access purchases, the license options that we offer, what is being chosen.
So I would like to just second the comments that Darla and Stefano have made. And there is some data, if you look at the options that bioarchive authors are offered and how many actually opt for the CC BY license, it's a relatively small proportion, certainly not a majority. And just anecdotally, I know that there are authors who did not realize when they choose a CC BY license that they're basically relinquishing all control over the content that they've published. So I think we have to be very careful to distinguish between open access and the type of Creative Commons license that you require. I could see requiring Creative Commons licensing, but I would not restrict it to CC BY.
We have a request from the video conferencers to please announce your name before speaking. Thank you.
Rita Sheeman, American Physiological Society. I wanted to add to this last conversation and support with what just been said, particularly two issues of VCC BY. I think we have, for our open access, we use the most liberal license, and we do have a number of our authors requesting different types of licenses and whether that's possible. I also wanted to address what Stefano said about mission creep. I didn't want to put it negatively, but I think that's a good way of framing it for me, that if there is the idea of preprint and preprint for just an open availability of the material, it is a different product than if it's used for grant review. And this is where you get a lot of other restrictions coming in and a lot of other purposes. The material is maybe not written for that purpose. And this has been, I think, something that perplexes me. There is perhaps a difference between publishing preprint for the reasons we said and good reasons and using that material for grant review and the kinds of things one's looking for. The other piece, and before you started speaking, I was wondering a little bit more about the ASAP Bio plans for governance. And after you spoke, I was also then wondering how some of what you said jives with ASAP Bio's plans for governance.
I could just make one comment before we discuss the governance, which I think is an excellent point. And I think Ron will also tell you about a task force that we're also planning to address this issue further. But I just want to address the idea that Creative Commons, CC BY, relinquishes all rights. So I've conducted a very small informal survey of biologists asking them why do they not choose CC BY licenses when they have an option at a preprint. And one response that I get is that they are afraid that no one will attribute them properly. So I think there is this misconception that CC BY relinquishes the right of attribution. And this is kind of serious because I think that in most of our academic culture, we use CC BY. It's very actually consistent with CC BY, the idea that we can make use of other people's materials, but we need to cite them appropriately. I think that's very close to our academic tradition. So I think there's quite a bit of education that needs to happen within the community about what these Creative Commons licenses actually mean.
Yeah, just to echo that, I think most scientists really have no idea what these licenses are, including a few months ago, myself included. I would say overall, this is, you know, exactly the kind of thoughtful discussion that multiple parts of the scientific enterprise have to have, but where those discussions, I think, haven't really been conducted in an informative, open way. And it was pretty clear when we were thinking about this central service, by the way, which may end up being rebranded some other name in the future, but and that we just put in a request for applications, which will be for, it's open to anyone. And we're going to be receiving applications for providers that can create this kind of aggregator service. But the one issue that was too complicated to hardwire in to that application was this issue of licensing. It was too complicated for us to hardwire into this request for application at this time. And so what we thought we'd do was to take a slower, more thoughtful route into this discussion by, first of all, creating a task force, which Jessica and I are kind of formulating right now, to really think through licensing. And we'd like to get just a number of thoughtful people, including legal professionals, societies, publishers, scientists, who can also think through the existing licensing as well as the possibility actually on the table of a custom license for a material going into the central service. So we are going to discuss the creation of this very soon. Again, like everything that we do at ASAP Bio, the intention is to be very public, very open. Our also view is that in complex problems like this, you know, our role here is not to make decisions, but is actually to engage the community in a thoughtful discussion and determine whether or not there is a consensus after, you know, really all the good arguments are put on the table. So in general, like our plan here is to get this task force going right now, just because it is something that's bubbling up in many settings. And ultimately, and I believe we put this in the RFA as well, that the issue of licensing is not even going to be handled by ASAP Bio, but this is an example of an important issue that should be put in front of a governance body, you know, which we hope to create. So in fact, you know, the level of discussion here is, I think first this task force is going to think through the issues, create open engagement with the public, you know, probably, you know, discuss some recommendations. But anyway, this may be something that the governance body will think through later. With regard to the governance body, I could just say where we are with this right now. You know, the goal is to, again, create, you know, a governance body that is thinking through all of these issues, what we're talking about for preprints. And as, you know, Neil said, it's also going to be a moving target. It's, you know, as scholarly communication changes, the notion that we can figure everything out perfectly and hardwired in for the next 20 years is, you know, foolhardy. I think, but at the same time, we don't want to have fragmented decision making all over, which is just going to create confusion. So I think the notion, just like the protein database, things that are great public repositories, you know, we view that this is, again, a public good, the whole world of preprints, and it needs to be, you know, governed by a thoughtful, you know, collective body. So what we are doing right now is engaging in a 25-person diverse task force. We have already polled them for a number, I would say, of decision-making questions about what the bylaw should look like for a governance body. And we are now at the stage where we've integrated all of that information and have created a provisional bylaws, which are back just very recently to that task force. Again, later those bylaws will be, we're going to ask the public, especially for some key decision-making points in that bylaw. But anyway, the goal is to actually craft a set of bylaws that will, you know, allow this governance body to be created and act for years to come. And it's, you know, its main scope of duty, I would say, is the corpus of work in this central service that will be created. So in that, just the way a governance body is involved in like your PMC or the protein data bank. Our hope is that even before the central service takes actual form and people start building it, that governance body will be in effect. And at least our hope right now is that it will be in effect in the summer with its, you know, first members. I don't want to go through all the details of what it will be and how many people, et cetera. The one thing that I would say very clearly is that there is a very clear intention that this is an international governance body, that that you know, this is not a U.S. issue. This is like a public goods for the entire scientific enterprise, which is global. And our very strong intention is that there will be international representation on this governance body. So anyway, that's where we're moving through, both through thinking through some of these difficult things with licensing, and also where we are with the governance body now.
I'd like to back up in terms of assumptions a little bit. I understand that you're looking for consensus in the scientific community, but I didn't see any evidence that there had been consensus that you need a central repository that includes full text and enhancements, as opposed to a central repository of metadata, sort of a PubMed for preprints, which would seem to me to be very valuable and not restrict where people are currently comfortable publishing their preprints.
Okay, certainly. So I think that, first of all, I agree with you that metadata indexing is very important, and we actually have entities that are currently doing this now. PrePubMed is a community-driven project. Preprints at Open Science, on the Open Science framework, also index metadata through SHARE. But I think that to return to the point that Neil made earlier, that especially as machine cognition and machine interpretation of preprints becomes more and more important, and as individual entities may consider developing new services for discussion of preprints, and I think we're going to hear about, you know, a one discussion platform later today, that it may be useful to make the full text available in this way, and certainly for any process that requires passing that text as data to software, having a single source of that software, that data, would be very valuable. So a single corpus rather than separate databases located elsewhere.
I understand, and I understand all the rationale behind thinking this would be valuable. My question was a little different, which was about how did you establish consensus that this is desirable? Because frankly, I haven't heard that kind of discussion. If you think of the ecology of scientific publishing now, you have disparate journals with disparate policies. They've all converged towards a fairly common practice of how to publish online, for example, and how to be indexed, and how to make content available. And I would think that within that kind of community, this, what you're looking for, would emerge rather than a top-down attempt to centralize and control full text of all preprints.
Can I make a comment for that? So from NIH's perspective, it hasn't converged. It's converged on the reading side with some conventions, but in terms of machine access, APIs, and other kinds of things, it's really difficult. And even for us to simply track the papers that come out of NIH funding and how those NIH funds are used or those papers are cited is also extremely difficult. And we've paid outside services, we've developed our own systems, and it's dealing with this fragmentation. And so even if we have the license and the subscription, it's the electronic access that causes all kinds of problems because they aren't standardized in any way. And so that's one of the reasons why NIH is very interested in this. And so, you know, I can't speak to consensus for all science, but I can tell you what our interests are. We need to, you know, we're supporting these papers, they're taxpayer funded. We need to know what they are, and we need to be able to track them and get at those papers.
I also just, and then we should have a coffee break, but I want to say this did not come out of the blue. We had, I would say, especially two pivotal meetings on this subject matter. One where a lot of this was discussed at a meeting for multiple funding agencies at the NIH. That was in May last year. And that, you know, there was sufficient interest from that group to at least think this through further that we then had a technical workshop where, you know, a different skill set of people really thought through this issue of, first of all, what the central service should look like. Should everything be in PDF? Should we move beyond the PDF? All of that information is publicly available on the website. So, I mean, you can actually drill down onto every issue. It's all public. There was also a technical report that emerged, which was, again, written kind of as a collection of about 30 people that kind of framed some of the, kind of the backbone of this request for application. So I would say that, this was really involved multiple parts of the scientific enterprise into creating this RFA, at least as thoughtfully as we could. I mean, no doubt every issue that you put in front of the scientific community will look like a spread that you saw from, Neil. It is virtually impossible to get 100% consensus on anything. But
can I ask how many of you were at one of those meetings as publishers? Can you raise your hand?
I was at the technical one last fall.
So, Ron, you had one person, and here you have the nonprofit publishers represented. So that's, I think, what Barbara is conveying.
We had representatives from a bunch of journals.
Yeah.
ASAP Bio meeting.
Well, the technical workshop was also live, so it could have been viewed by anyone. The problem also with the meeting that we had at HHMI, the notion is that, again, even that meeting that you were at, that was 75 people, and there's hundreds of thousands of people around the room. So, we did try to make all of these meetings, accessible to anyone that wanted to.
No, I don't want to take a negative spin on this, Ron, at all. And the meeting at HHMI where I was and we had this conversation was like the jump starting. It was a great meeting. What I think Barbara is addressing right now is, this specific issues of metadata and data collection and machine learning that I don't think you have heard from the nonprofit publishers enough about that. Mm-hmm. And seems like that's been the case. And I'm not saying that we're the only stakeholder, but certainly because actually I'm going to be mentioned later in my talk, I think this is very germane to us because the difference is that we as society represent the forums for our disciplines. And so what the society do, it's typically not just publishing, but they do many, many other activities that involve, if you wish, derivatives, of what the knowledge presented is. And so we have concerns about, how we can weave this into all the fabric of our scientific community. So I don't want you to take this as a negative thing. I'm just saying, and I remember when you organized the NIH meeting, I told you, can I be there? And you said no. And the reason was a good reason, because as it's not geared toward that. But I think that the issues are interweaved, and that's the point.
Yes. So thank you. I hope we can continue this discussion around noon. We also have Dr. Patty Brennan, who's just joined us via video conference. Could you, I don't know if we'll be able to hear you, Patty, if you could. Oh, you seem to be muted. Hold on. Let me try something. Give me one moment.
No, just to also address that, I think engagement of the community is so important. I mean, I think that's why I think we made progress generally on this issue rather than having a stalemate, for the past year. I also will say, even when there's a governance body that is being formed, obviously it is going to be of limited number.
Hello. Hi, guys. Whatever you've done. Hi, guys. Can you hear me? No.
Scientific community. And, recognizing that there are multiple parts of the system that really have to work together. So issues like what metadata to choose, or what ethical standards, or all of these issues are really a partnership between, the system going forward and multiple stakeholders. And, you know, if this is going to work, this is going to be part technology, maybe 5%, and 95% culture and sociology. And just recognizing that up front, and recognizing that all of these issues are going to be a conversation, you know, is just has to be part of the fabric of how this whole system works.
So, Dr. Brennan, could you try speaking once more? Okay. Unfortunately, we are not able to hear you right now. Maybe try one
Jessica,
more.
Jessica, can you hear me? Jessica?
I can hear you, Maria. Is that Maria? Hello, I can hear you, Maria.
Yeah. Hello, can you hear me? This is
yes,
Patty.
Can you just fine. Oh, hello?
Hello, this is Patty Brennan. Can you hear me now?
Patty. Yes, I can
hear
you.
Okay, there it works.
Thank you so much.
It works.
Wonderful. Okay, great.
I'm just sure if you just tap enough buttons, you can be heard anywhere.
Okay. Okay, so we can also see you. So,
excellent. Thank you,
Dr. Brennan, for joining us.
Terrific. I'm very happy to be participating in this brief part of the meeting. I want to express the really strong support from the NIH and in my role as the Interim Associate Director of Data Science for both the enthusiasm and, frankly, some of the cautions that are being raised, because we're talking about a new model of dissemination, and many of the features that have already been raised by this group, including how would you locate it and who would pay for it and how would you sustain it, really it remain to be understood better. But we don't believe they need to be completely resolved before we continue to go forward in this way, and we are excited about the multi-funders opportunities that should bring us into resolving some of these issues and getting better understanding. I have not heard any of the conversation so far to date, and I've only been on a short few minutes, about whether there's been conversation at the level of the universities around career trajectories for our young scholars. But I know as we're changing the dissemination within the biomedical sciences that the conversation also has to go on at a cultural level in the universities and in the schools themselves to help understand both the value of accelerating scientific dissemination and opening science, as well as the shifting understanding of what the concept of peer review means and where it fits into work. We believe at the National Library of Medicine, where I'm also the director, that having archival publications as evidence of critical findings from research, particularly research that will eventually move into human health, will be essential. So we're not advocating in any way the dissolution of the publication process, but rather the augmenting of it through these opportunities. I'd be happy to take questions if it's time for that, and otherwise I'd be happy to just congratulate you on your efforts today.
If there's any questions from others on the video conference as well.
But maybe I was going to say something about the earlier discussion. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Hi.
Yes.
I'll also say hello and turn on my video just in case this works. Hi, guys. So I wanted to say something. This is Maria from EMBO in Heidelberg. Some of our people were on some of these workshops, the technical workshop, the RFA, the funders workshop. And I think I agree with people around the table that issues were discussed there, but lots of things weren't resolved. And so I would very much advocate those issues that are being brought up around the table being collected. And I think we should be explicit that on some of these issues, we indeed have listened only to not only a small number of people, Ron, but rather a particular segment of stakeholders. And perhaps the governance body should think about that and you know, should look at that very carefully. Because I think we have here a sort of dichotomy of the ideal. Of course everybody would like CC BY. Of course everybody would like the greatest possible of data mining, text mining on the text. But on the other hand, we have the community who can't necessarily pay for open access referred, who may want a quick solution, and whom we have to engage and get on board. So I think I think the comments that were made around the table are very pertinent to this, and the governance board should look into that very carefully. It's not about the number of people that anyone can talk to at any given time. Also around the table, we have only a small number, but they represent a different segment from those that have talked before. And I think this is a very valuable exercise to collect the feedback there and see to what extent where we should settle between the ideal that we probably all agree on and the reality that we need to get the whole project running fast.
Well, I just want to say I agree with you, Maria. In fact, it might be a good conclusion at the end of this meeting to kind of like summarize some of these issues that you know, the group feel is are not fully resolved, and actually that will help us because that will be part of the starting work for this governance body. So I think that actually would be a great outcome of this meeting.
So, given our time constraints and that we have Phil Bourne, who will be giving us a presentation very soon, I hope that we can now move to a coffee break for about 15 minutes and then get started once again with Phil Bourne's presentation at approximately 11:05. Thank you.
And
thank you,
everybody.
Thank you very much, and I'll be leaving you now. Enjoy your coffee.
I really appreciate your comments. And, again, feel free to email me anything over time, too.
Thank you. Bye now.
Thank you. Yeah, and I was thinking, you know, in terms of conversation, because